In today's class, we're going to take a look at regular expressions and how we use them in Perl. I'm not going to give a complete introduction to the topic of regular expressions. I'm going to assume that you're familiar with some of the concepts of regular expressions. If you haven't come across them before, you should take an introductory regular expression textbook or another online class that tells you about regular expressions in more detail. I want to go through how we use regular expressions in Perl and some of the strengths of using those regular expressions. It's one of the things that Perl is really the most famous for. Our standard notation for a regular expression in Perl is using this construct. We have a string, a scalar, and we use the equal sign and the tilde, which is the shift character next to the number one, and then we use an M for match, and typically two slashes. The way that we do this, for example, is if we have a string with ROB, and we say, does this string match the characters ROB? In this case, it'll return true. A very trivial case, that string has those characters, there's a match, we return true. Regular expressions in Perl have a very similar notation to other languages, including Python, that we talk about elsewhere. And the standard wildcard characters that we use are a period to match any character, an asterisk to match zero or more characters, and a plus sign to match one or more characters. There are some special characters that have special meanings in regular expressions, not just in Perl, but in all regular expressions. For example, a slash means, quote, the next meta character. If I want to include a match to a period, I can't use a period because that would match any character. If I use slash period, it means match a period specifically. A caret means match the beginning of the line. As I mentioned, a period means match any character, asterisk, more than one character, etc., etc. The dollar sign means match the end of a line or the end before a new line. A horizontal line, usually the shift of the key above your enter on your keyboard, means match one thing or another thing. And then round brackets are used for grouping, for catching results that we're going to use later on. And square brackets are used for grouping characters together for different kinds of matches. And I'll show you examples of both of those in just a second. As I've mentioned, the asterisk means match zero or more times. So for example, R asterisk means match zero or more asterisks. A plus means match one or more times. O plus means match one or more O's. And a question mark means match one or zero times. So maybe you match or you don't match. And then we can use numbers within curly brackets to indicate the number of times that we should match. So a single number within curly brackets means match exactly that number of times. A single number followed by a comma means match at least that number of times. And then two numbers, N and M, separated by a comma means match at least N times, but not more than M times. So the idea is that if we want to match between 1 and 10 times, we can match. For example, we can use curly brackets, 1, 10. If we had a character, so A, curly brackets, 1, 10, would match at least 1 and not more than 10 times. That would match something like this, where we have 3 A's, it would match 4 A's and 5 A's and so on. If we say A1, comma, that means match one time and as many possible times as we can match. And if we say A1, oops, without the comma, that means match just one time. As I mentioned, very, very similar notations to other languages. There's a standard for regular expressions, and Perl adheres to those standards. There are some specific escape characters that you should be familiar with. A slash W, lowercase w, means match to word characters. Word characters include A through Z, capital A through capital Z, 0 through 9, and underscore. A slash D means match only the digits, 0 through 9. A match S means match to white space. And then we can invert those matches by using slash capital W, mean non-word characters, so everything else in the alphabet except A through Z, 0 through 9, and underscore. Capital D means match non-digits, so that would match all of the letters, but it wouldn't match 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, etc. Capital S means match to non-white space. So we have words, digits, and white space, not words, not digits, and not white space. And then the last one I've listed here, the boundary character, means match to this transition between a word and another word. And that transition can be white space. For example, between the word match and the word to, there's a white space. So we would match after the H and before the white space. But that transition could also be a period or a comma or an exclamation mark or any other of many special characters that indicate the end of a word. There are some special characters that are called escape sequences. So how do you match to a tab? A tab is kind of an ephemeral thing that we have. We press the tab key and we get a tab. We use the slash T nomenclature. And we've seen that when we were looking at splitting lines in a previous lecture. Slash N is for new line, and slash R is for return. And there are some other things like form feed and alarm, which we're going to use a little less frequently. So here are some example regular expressions on this particular string, my name is Rob. So first of all, if we say, does this string match slash S lowercase plus. That means one or more white space characters. Does it match? That's true. There's a white space character here, here, and here. If we said, does this string match a lowercase r? That's false. There's a capital R, but there's no lowercase r. Does this string contain a lowercase y? That's true. There's a lowercase y right after the m. Does it contain an uppercase y? That's false. Does it contain a capital R? That's true. And does it contain a number, a numeric character? And that, of course, is false. There's no number in that string. And then, lastly, does it contain a slash capital D? Remember what that means? That means not a number. Does this string contain some character that's not a number? That's true. Which character would that map against? I'm not going to tell you. You guys can figure that out for yourself. Okay, so in each of these cases, we use the same nomenclature. We have an equals, a tilde, and this match character. We use M for match, and S for substitute. So if we start with a simple string like Rob, and we say match capital R, that's true. If we say S, that means substitute, a capital R for a capital B, our string now becomes Bob. Let me show you some more substitute examples. Here are three very common examples that we use all the time. In the first case, we substitute a slash S plus, so that means one or more white space characters, for a single space. So that's going to take all those cases where you accidentally pressed spacebar twice or three times or four times and move them down to a single space. What does the second example match? A caret. The caret, remember, means match at the beginning of the line. Then we have a slash S, and then we have a plus. Match at the beginning of the line, and then one or more white space characters. And we replace that with nothing. We just have two slashes. There's nothing between them here. So this means match any white space at the beginning of a line and remove it. Similarly, the third example here means match any white space at the end of a line and remove it. So we have some modifiers that we can also apply to our regular expressions, just like in other languages. We can read a whole file and treat that as multiple lines, matching each new line as a line break. By saying slash S at the end, we can treat as a single line. That means match a new line as a single character. So a period would match just a new line. We can do case insensitive searches. We can allow white space in our searches. That's really something that people use just to make their regular expressions clearer. We can match globally, and we can execute code. Out of these modifiers, the two that you'll use most frequently are case insensitive searching and global matching. Here we've got our string substitutions, and we've added our modifier to say do a global search. Does this actually make sense? In the first case, what we'll do is we'll remove every case where we have one or more white space characters, and we'll replace all of them with just a single white space character, one at a time. So between every word, we'll replace all of those with a white space character. In the second case, we're matching at the beginning, and in the third case, we're matching at the end. Adding the global modifier to those searches doesn't make any sense. So let's go back to our example regular expressions that we previously looked at and add some modifiers and see what happens. If we say, does this string contain white space? Yes, it does. That's the same one that we saw before. That's true. Does it contain an R in a case insensitive search? It does. It contains a capital R. Remember, that didn't match a lowercase r before, but now we have a capital R that matches. Does it contain a Y? Yes, it does. And it doesn't matter about the case insensitivity because it's a lowercase y. Does it contain a capital Y with the case insensitive modifier? Yes, it does. Does it contain a capital R? Yes, it does. Does it contain a single digit? No, it doesn't contain a digit. And there's no modifier we can apply. It's a digit. We can't look for a digit that looks like a non-digit. That doesn't make sense. And then finally, does it contain some non-digit character? Yes, it does. Have you guys figured out what that non-digit character is yet that it matches? Well, regular expressions by default match at the beginning of the string. So in this case, we would match this capital M. Okay, let's take a look at grouping. So we can use parentheses to store our matches. The matches are saved as $1, $2, $3, $4, and so on. These are special variables that Perl has built in. So if we have a string that is Rob, and we say, does this string match a capital R with two other characters? And we surround that in parentheses that says, let's remember what that match was and put that in the $1 special variable. And so now $1 becomes Rob, becomes the whole string. We can use these special variables in substitutions. Here's one that you may see in other people's code. Let's break down this match and see what happens. So first of all, we have a string. We're going to use a regular expression because we have this equals and a tilde. And we're going to substitute. We're going to match a single character. We're going to remember that. So that's going to be in $1. And then we're going to match more than one character. And we're going to remember those. And that's going to be in $2. What we're going to replace that match with is with uppercase $1 joined to $2. The E means execute this piece of code. Instead of replacing it physically with the characters U and C, we're going to execute that code as Perl code and replace them with the uppercase characters in $1. And the G means do that for every character in the string. Let's take a look and see what that regular expression does. Here's a string. $s is equal to, and I'm going to make my string A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T. Now I know my ABCs, Y, and Z. Okay. And I'm going to substitute for the first character and then multiple characters, uppercase $1, dot $2, eg. And then I'm going to print $s with a new line. Let's see. Now what we've done is we've taken every word on this string and we've replaced the first character in that word with an uppercase version of that character and left the rest of the word intact. As I've told you many times, programmers are lazy. And so we often type something like this. We have a string and we want to match some particular set of characters. So for example, here we're matching an R followed by two other characters. As I've also told you in a previous lecture, that in Perl, if you forget to provide a scalar where one's needed, Perl will just automatically use dollar underscore. So we can modify this by saying dollar underscore is applied to this regular expression. And in fact, since we're using dollar underscore, we don't actually need it. We can just say, let's apply this regular expression to dollar underscore. And then, because this is such a common thing to do in Perl, and Perl programmers are especially lazy, we really don't need that M. Because if we have the two diagonal lines, and we have a regular expression in the middle, we're pretty sure we've got a regular expression, and we're pretty sure we're going to use it in on dollar underscore. So in fact, we can just use the slash, the R, the two periods, and another slash to mean that regular expression. So that pretty much ends our brief overview of regular expressions in Perl. As I've said, go take a look at the full syntax of regular expressions, and they're going to come up in other classes as we go through, and you should really understand in great detail how regular expressions work.